Hi everyone, welcome back to Understanding Volumes. In the last tutorial, I covered how to use aero volume to drive particle movements. Today we're going to create clouds through advection. The basic steps are like this. We start with a mesh geometry, convert it into a volume, and generate a voxel field from this volume. Then we advect this voxel field using a vector field and convert the advected field back to a volume to form the cloud. So let's dive right in. Here I've created an ellipsoid as the starting geometry. Let's bring it into Bifrost. As we learned before, we can use a mesh to volume to convert the mesh into a volume. Select store level set so that we have the sign distance stored for each voxel. Change the resolution mode to absolute. I'm going to set the detail size to 0.01. Get a voxel field to generate a field from the voxel sign distances. Now to advect a voxel field, we use the node advect field. Advection is the transport of a substance by the motion of a fluid, and the properties of the substance are carried with it during the advection. What this node does is that it takes an input field, either scalar or vector, and uses a velocity field that we provide to drive the advection of the property that's associated with each position of the input field. The result is a field with changed values that reflect the advected property. In this case, the property is the sign distance. In the input voxel field, the value at each position is the interpolated voxel sign distance. When we apply a velocity field, the sign distance property advects along these vectors, resulting in a changed sign distance value at each position. These changed values will be used later to create the fog density for the cloud. Let's connect the voxel field to the port field and get a fractal turbulence field as the velocity field that drives the advection. Here in the time step window, we can specify how long we want it to advect. I'll come back and adjust this value later. Now let's get a field to volume. Make sure the field interpretation is set to sign distance field, and the store fog density is selected. This way it voxelizes the advected field based on the sign distance values, and calculates the fog density for each voxel. I'm going to change the resolution mode to absolute, and set the detail size to 0.03. Let's assign material to the volume to visualize it. Go to Hypershade, under Arnold, select AI Standard Volume, and use default Bifrost arrow as the preset. Drag it into Bifrost, get an assigned material, and connect the geometry and material to it. Connect the out geometry to a terminal. Now we see the volume. It doesn't look like a cloud yet. I'm going to adjust some of the parameters. If I increase the time of the advection, we see that the shape deviates more from the starting geometry. We can also increase the magnitude of the fractal turbulence field to have higher velocities that result in a faster advection. Let's also increase the frequency to give it a more ragged appearance. To introduce more variations, I'm going to multiply the fractal turbulence field with a fractal noise field. For the fractal noise field, I'm going to offset it a little by adding to it a scalar field. I'm going to use 0.5 for the magnitude of the noise field and 0.4 for the scalar field. The scalar field changes the range of the noise values so that most of them are positive and wouldn't reverse the directions of the vectors. Alternatively, you can use an F-curve field to change the range of the noise field. Multiply the result with the fractal turbulence field. and I'm going to increase the frequency of the noise field. Now it looks more like a cloud. But the shape is still too uniform. That's partly because the starting geometry is very symmetrical. To break from the symmetry, I'm going to displace the mesh points of the ellipsoid with the fractal noise. Let's get a displaced points. And a fractal noise. In reality, the bottom of the clouds is often flatter than the top. To imitate that, I'm going to establish a relationship between the y position of the mesh point and the weight of the displacement, so that in general, the higher the position, the more displacement it gets. Let's get a get point position and a vector 3 to scalar to get the coordinates of the mesh points. Then we can use a change range to map the y values into a different range. If we use this result as the magnitudes of the fractal noise, the positions with higher y values would have larger magnitude and therefore more displacement. Connect the point positions to positions and the noise values to weights. Connect the out points to the terminal and we see the displaced geometry. Now let's use this displaced geometry as the starting geometry for the volume. We can easily adjust the range of the magnitude as well as the other parameters of the fractal noise to modify the overall shape of the cloud. That's how we create a cloud. To further elaborate it, we can use an iterate compound to iteratively advect the voxel field instead of doing it just once. If you're new to iterations in Bifrost, be sure to watch the iteration tutorial that I made earlier. So let's get an iterate. Select these nodes that we used for advecting the voxel field and put them inside the iterate compound. Connect the advected field to the output. We also need the input field. Let's go back outside and connect the voxel field to the iterate compound. We want to update the voxel field after each iteration, so let's set the port state to advected field. This constructs a feedback loop where the advected field from one iteration becomes the input voxel field for the next iteration. I'm going to set the max iterations to 3 for now. Connect the advected field to the node field to volume, and we see the cloud. If we increase the number of iterations, we see more advection and, as a result, a more ragged cloud. I'm going to set it back to 3 and modify the iterate compound to improve the details. Right now, for every iteration, we get the same noise values at each position from both the fractal turbulence and fractal noise fields. To make them evolve, we can provide a constantly changing value to the port time. Here we have the current index, which is incremented by 1 over each iteration. So we can use this index as an indicator of the time. Let's convert it to a float. Scale it. Create a scalar field of this value. and connected to the time. Additionally, for each iteration, I also want to change the magnitude of the velocity field as well as the time step of the advection. I've created this descent compound, which uses a formula to generate a gradually decreasing number over the iterations. When we connect the value of the current index to it, each iteration would have a smaller number than the previous one. You can adjust these parameters to control the scale of this value and how fast it decreases. Let's connect the output to the magnitude of the fractal turbulence field. Copy and paste it, and connect the output to the time step of the advect field. This way, both the magnitude of the velocity field and the length of the advection time will be diminishing over the iterations, so that we'll have more significant advection at first, followed by finer and subtler movements. Right now, it advects too much, so let's make the time step smaller and decrease faster as well by adjusting these parameters. I'm going to increase the exponent to 3, decrease the scale to 1, and increase the constant to 1.3. You can play with these parameters to find a look that you like. If I start with just one iteration and gradually increase the number of iterations, you'll see how the volume changes. With this method, we can create a large area of scattered clouds. Here in another graph, I've created a group of ellipsoids. These ellipsoids were generated through scattering points and creating instances. And I displaced them using the same method that I showed earlier in this tutorial. Let's go to the first graph that we just finished. Copy and paste all these nodes that we used for generating the cloud, and paste them in this new graph with the scattered geometries. Before I connect the meshes, I'm going to increase the detail size to 0.2, because creating a large number of clouds can be quite demanding on the computer. Starting with a lower resolution, we can make sure that it doesn't crash. Now let's connect the meshes to the mesh to volume node. And we see the clouds. We can gradually decrease the detail size to get a higher resolution. That's it for today. I hope this series helps you understand volumes and how they can be applied in creating shapes and effects. Let us know if you have any questions. Thanks for watching, stay tuned, and we'll see you soon.